we're going to, thanks a ton, be getting on to the first of two consecutive presentations on the one hand, human ethics considerations involving the sort of data that we are talking about here, and then subsequently a presentation concerning recruitment and retention within studies. Both of these are large, recurrent issues associated with smartphone-based data collection studies. Both merit longer discussion, but because of the abbreviated nature of this this boot camp for 3 days, I've had to restrain my coverage to a core set of issues. But I'm glad to dialogue about the broader issues as participant interest and questions. Within the first of these topics, considerations, I'm going to be addressing two components. First, I'm going to be talking about some of the ethical considerations that come in when dealing with these studies. But I'm going to predominantly do so in the context of talking about also dealing with institutional research review boards and our research ethics boards here in Canada with respect to these studies, and systematically working to address concerns that come up. To help you in this task, I'm going to be providing a set of slides, but beyond that, I want to make sure that everyone leaves this event with a set of reference material in the form of ethics submission packages, consent forms, and recruitment materials that have been successful in navigating the maze of different human ethics board concerns out there. Related to this is the observation that having gone through dozens of different studies, dozens of different ethics review boards as part of those different studies, my observation is that one of the few rules within this area is that ethics boards vary a lot from ethics board to ethics board with respect to considerations. And the standards are different. Those standards are changing over time with respect to attitudes towards these sort of studies, but not always in a way that makes them more open. The concerns differ. The level of familiarity with the questions differ. I find that we are addressing different needs over time than we did, say, 5 years ago. So there's a set of issues here that I'd like to speak about. Some of the major ones are listed here. First is that variability. When it comes to network recruitment, I'll talk a little bit about snowball sampling and respondent-driven designs for network-based recruitment. Suffice it to say that if you're recruiting in networks, say you're recruiting egocentric networks, a person and several contacts within their network, as we've done for some studies, or if you're if you are engaged in recruitment, say, in a school context or in a professional context where you're engaged in snowball sampling, successively reaching out to network contacts, this does require blinded referrals. While technologically it will be very straightforward to for us to follow up with contacts directly, that ethics boards are often uncomfortable with names being given to us as the study designers and study administrators that include names of people who haven't yet agreed to be part of the study or contact information for them. And so whilst it would be straightforward from a technologic standpoint to be given email addresses, which we could then email and say that, you know, a friend referred you to a study, this is information about the study, would you like to opt in? A lot of the time we're told that that's off the table. You can't do that because it would involve advancing information, email addresses, say, for people who have not yet elected to offer it through their contacts. A third, so I'll come back to that a little bit. A third issue is collectively identifiable. The observation from ethics boards and others, expert observers here, is that while any one data source collected by Ethica, for example, might have limited potential for identifiability, it has some potential for capturing certain aspects of a person's identity. Collectively, if you triangulate between these different components, from information about contact patterns, information about location, information related to the baseline surveys that they answered, it may be possible to identify from this set of different material. And much of the discomfort or concerns that I hear within the ethics context relate to navigating this issue of, you know, is this identifying not in any one piece, but is it identifying in toto? An important question, and one that has been brought to us as questions about our study. Two related issues are aspects of notifiable behavior. So if an individual is expressing suicidal ideation, for example, or expresses concerns about bullying or harassment, what are our ethical obligations for responding to that situation? We've had a number of studies which we've run related to suicidal ideation. Those studies benefited in a subset of cases, such as those worked on by Tina, because they were conducted within institutional contexts where care was already being delivered for these individuals. And therefore, there was an assumption that suicidal ideation was part of their clinical involvement of the professionals, and that therefore it was to be assumed. You know, the issue grows more concerned yet when you're dealing with individuals in the community, and there's a question about response, and there's a question about whether an individual in the study might reach out to us in hopes of securing help, but with the misunderstanding that we will be monitoring their cries for help on an ongoing basis, where in fact it's episodic, or, you know, only months afterwards. So a certain amount of consent education relates to this. It relates to the fact, for example, helping them educate them that we will not be examining this sort of data until their time in the study is finished, so they don't. They don't have that sense that they can reach out to us as a lifeline. They're not encumbered by the belief that Ethica instantly transmits the data and all sorts of things. It may not be true because of lack of network connectivity. Law-breaking activities is another point of concern. What if one of our participants is witness to, or in some sense potentially involved in, law-breaking activity? Maybe they are witness to a bank robbery, and there is a court of law that subpoenas our records involving their data. What is our ethical obligation what is our legal obligation as far as providing this data, which was promised to be in confidence to the participant, for to lawmakers or to law enforcement. So lawbreaking activities are a case where there may be subpoenas records, and it may sound far-fetched, but you know, when you're dealing with low SCP populations who live closer to the edge, we have had cases where there's family members who are uncomfortable with their spouse being part of the study because potentially there's activities that they don't want to necessarily be caught. We had one study participant in Regina for a study that involved homeless and indigent individuals where their phone was lost because it was in a car that they had to flee because of police presence. So they had to flee, there were drugs in the car, they left their phone in the car as part of it, and we were unable to continue to involve them in the study. In that case, potentially, the GPS trace on that phone by police as to where they had come from, who they visited with respect to the drugs. It's never happened for us, but it could. And we've been assured by institutional parties that this is defended within Canada, that our institution will go to court to us for us and basically argue that we are not obligated to provide data. Smartphone use in vehicles, this comes up quite a bit. I think Cheryl's seen this quite a bit. Institutional review boards want us to communicate to people. In no event is a driver to respond to an Ethica questionnaire whilst driving. Which, you know, it stands to reason, but they want that in plain language and in potentially boldface within consent forms to make sure that no one, out of a misbegotten sense of study obligation, picks up that phone in a way that could put their lives or the life of others at risk. Another case is audiovisual recording of people or voices that could be identified. So in one study for the study in Regina, which involved many homeless people, as well as many lower income people and some higher income people, it was a study of HIV positive. One of the things we asked was taking a photo of their pharmaceuticals, so their heart regimen, their highly active antiretrovirals, which is so important for keeping their viral load level low and lowering both their clinical rate of clinical progression and the risk to others through sexual contact or by needle sharing and other mechanisms. Other pathways. And one of the concerns here was make sure those photos have no chance of showing, for example, when taking their pills, some information on the pill bottle that says who they are, by showing their prescription number or their address or their name. And you also don't want that photo to show someone in the background that didn't agree to it. Right? Same thing with audio recording. You don't want to have audio recorded that might include someone's voice that we say, we know that person, that's a name, and he stands exposed, because of this. So audio could, in principle, capture someone in video, most certainly, right? Video of an event. So setting standards for that and communicating those standards in consent. Instructing both in person and in consent form, in a written form, helping them understand that when it comes to audiovisual recording, there's gravity associated with it, that although it may seem like a minor matter to snap a photo, in fact, they have to be careful to do so in a way that won't put themselves or others who aren't even part of the study at risk of being shown associated with behaviors or with conditions like HIV, which might be pose privacy. And so that involves education. And you'll see in some of the consent forms that I share with you some evidence of. A central area of ethics concerns relate to sensitive information being collected. And I would highlight particularly contact pattern, geographic information, and any sort of medically significant information. So, you know, conditions, diagnoses, treatments, etc. Needless to say, HSINs or PHNs or identifying numbers as part of the health system here in Canada, or probably for HMOs, identifying numbers in the States. So medical information has extra levels of concern associated with HIPAA, the Health Information Privacy Protection Act, and with its equivalent in, or its cognate in Canada, PIPEDA. And this is something Ethica has had to go through is a level of certification as to compliance with processes involved in maintaining medical information. Certain types of studies related to these have a high degree of scrutiny. Now, associated with this is, I should have put here, and I'm not sure why it's not, there's almost always questions about a couple of things, and I hit a slide that I should have put there, but I'll make sure that this is down when I post the final version of these slides. Almost always we get questions, and reasonable questions, about where data is stored, including nationally. Does the data live in Canada, or does it live in Australia for an Australian study? Is data collected by Alberta Health Services stored in Alberta, or is it in Saskatchewan? Is it stored by any chance in the US, in which case it's subject to the Patriot Act? Is the data transmitted from channels that it could include the US? There's a lot of concern outside the US on the part of Canadian and Australian authorities, and maybe also in Europe. Mohammed's dealt more with clients in Europe. But just wanting to be sure that data is not subject to Patriot Act peering from our U.S. neighbors. That's a recurrent question. Another question that comes up is encryption. How is the data stored on the phone? How is the data transmitted from the phone to Ethica servers? Once on the servers, where is it physically located? And how is it protected? To what degree is it exposed to hacking? Those are almost always questions which, very commonly, those come up. And Mohammed could comment on the encryption side of this, but it's encrypted on the device and it's encrypted in transit, which generally makes the ethics rules more comfortable with that. So if the phone is stolen, it'll be gibberish to someone who breaks in and tries to look at that data. Those are some recurrent considerations that come up. There's a set of studies that are particularly sensitive. These include intervention studies, studies that involve potentially identifying information, studies involving special populations that are vulnerable to stigma and to discrimination. This might be people living with HIV/AIDS. It could involve individuals who are a vulnerable group, such as transgendered individuals. It could also involve individuals who are who have a history of past trauma or other abuse that may that they may not want to share, you know, with everyone who have a history of say drug abuse, even though they're now clean, they don't want history information to be shared. And you know, those involving patient medical information, and those involving explicitly charts or health records or external databases, you know, undergo particular scrutiny. A lot of our studies that we work with health information, we do so not with that information inside of Ethica. Rather, we take Ethica data and we reach out to it and link it through external frameworks like R or SAS or tools like Spark or Python, and we link it up with these medical data. The medical data are not put into Ethica so much as Ethica data is linked externally with that medical data. And that's often a, you know, a position of greater comfort for our institutional reviewers. Okay? So that's how we've tended to deal with these matters. But to the degree that that there is an inpatient use of Ethica, for example, to capture medical information, it raises additional questions on the part of institutional review boards that need to be addressed. Okay, so a few tips here, and I've a bunch more comments. So number one, engage early, often, and build relations. Or IRB. So before we started building Ethica's predecessor, while Ethica was still a speck in the cosmic eye, we went to our research ethics board here on campus. We went to actually representatives of the biomedical and the behavioral. And we sat down with them and said, look, this is what we can do technically. This is what some other people are doing elsewhere. We're, you know, maybe two or three projects worldwide on this. And we said, help us navigate this ethically. And that set the groundwork for a very productive relationship that lasted till about last year when the board turned over study coordinator left, and now we're kind of back to building relationships. This helps a lot to have ongoing understanding and a point of contact with the ethics board. You know, it'll help a lot also to have the IRBs and RBs to be pointed towards precedent. They're trying to, my observation is that many are trying to navigate the same area. They're trying to figure out what are our obligations in this new era of data collection, and pointing them to published work, pointing them to precedent in, as far as past studies. The many ethics boards outside the U of S who have passed off on this work, Columbia, Michigan, Harvard, et cetera, these are places that have given it close consideration. And sometimes it helps bring along the ethics board to understand that this has been seriously examined. One could also point to end user license agreements, the ULAs, which are not meaningful consent-seeking instruments that are commonly used to collect data on phones for commercial purposes, and where the sorts of work we're doing is minimal risk compared to the sort of work, the sort of data that's collected under end user license agreement. So the point is, there's a lot of this data being collected. We're going the extra mile in terms of trying to handle it with in an ethically forward fashion. So consent form, legal obligations with subpoenas, warning in the consent form about this or noting how it will be handled is important. We again have gotten strong consideration that at least for us, the lawyers stand behind us in terms of keeping that data secret, and that within Canada, that has never been successfully challenged by law enforcement personnel. That this data has a privileged position, and it's a position that reflects many lines of research, say, work with commercial sex workers, where you know, the individuals are in a position of being at risk of law enforcement, and are on the you know, sometimes on the wrong side of the law, but that is protected by the bond of researcher privilege and confidence, is what we're told. I can't speak to the situation. I don't know it with such clarity, but I am reassured in the Canadian context. So one thing we've done to very good effect is linked REBs to REBs. It said in policing, police share with police, and REBs share with REBs. So we have found linking up REBs with a corresponding person at another institution has worked with this system before, or has come to a degree of understanding of what the real issues is quite helpful. We have a set of documentation that I will be providing to you that's background information, but Mohammed has a better set yet. What is on the Ethica website is nothing in my mind short of remarkable in terms of documentation. There's an Ethica forum, and sort of aimed at a community site. There's Ethica documentation, there's tutorials, and there's a section of the Ethica site that provides background information on Ethica in some detail, which can be very useful for REBs and IRBs, using the sort of US side Canadian designation. We have other documentation on background on smartphone-based data collection and Ethica in particular that's a bit older. I'm glad to provide all that with you, but Mohammed's collection is, I think, the highest quality and the most current. And my hat is off to him, as on so many things. It's really remarkable. And I will mention, if any of you are seeking clarification on issues with Ethica, please be encouraged to post in the forum. Please be encouraged to reach out on the website. My students have told me, my colleagues have told me, just how quickly they get answers. And that again is great testimony to Mohammed's campaign. Use pilot and feasibility studies first. Try things small and contained to get going. Learn from an early study, and it helps the granting process. It helps the getting the IRB on board. It helps in terms of some of the judicious planning for the larger study. I will tell you, we have had, when it comes to IRB and REBs, we've had one very bad experience with the feasibility study. The feasibility study went great, but I had a very bad experience with an REB. Basically, we had a feasibility study which took enormous effort to pull together because it was the one with homeless individuals, with individuals who were lower income. We had issues, you know, very disordered individuals struggling with heroin addiction, et cetera, carrying the phones. And it was a feasibility study that was designed to inform us to scale up. But it's intensively longitudinally dense information. And we were interested in knowing about the day-to-day texture of the lives of these individuals, what they were reporting, for example, about their challenges being able to take their medication every day, their heart medication that's so critical for their health progress. And essentially, the REB involved, which was not ours here, it was another one, banned us from looking at the data. They said, this is a feasibility study. You're not allowed to look at anything except feasibility criteria. So they said it's scientifically improper of you to look at the data because the sample size. And it was like, okay, so you're telling us if we have 1,000 records from this participant, actually high hundreds, maybe it's 900 surveys answered by some participants, 800 by others, 600. And they said, okay, you're not allowed to look at that because you don't have enough participants to be representative sample. Sorry, you know, HIV infected individuals are also not a representative sample population, and they overstepped their grounds, but we swallowed and we said, okay, it took us year to negotiate it, and we said, okay, fine, we won't look at that data. Just let us run the study. And they did let us run the study, and it was just one bad experience. Be patient, though. They learn over time. I would say err on side of complying with concerns. I did it. We may re-examine the issue. Sometimes they overstep their grounds, and you go through the work, and then maybe you can build their comfort level so they'll actually let you look at the data that was collected. Sorry? This is Canada. I know in the U.S., even like presidents sue like news outlets, but welcome to the true North, strong and free. We should talk. We'll bring them along. I'm convinced. In any case, moving right along. So address specific worries. There are specific worries about driving, audiovisual recording, showing individual data that do need to be addressed. And these things can be addressed rather readily. And once you address them in one study, you can reuse them. We find ourselves reusing a lot of the text from one study. So it's not like you go through this work and you have to start all over at the beginning again. You can often end up securing, a strong asset by going through it once, and then continuing to use it. One form that we have found very helpful is to have tiered opt-in. You may think I'm referring to like weeping tears, but no, I'm actually, our experience with RRBs has been by and large very good. I have to say, our RRB here has been excellent over the years. And by and large, we've had little problem with others, with a couple of examples, which I could mention if people are interested. But opt-in strategies for tiered consent is something that has this nice feel to it. It's almost like a contingent contract in the sense that it helps address risk concerns on both sides. See, the idea here is that people can opt into the study at different levels of consent or provision. So some people might want to opt in only with the guarantees that their data will never be examined at an individual level. Others will opt in with the understanding that their data will never be published at an individual level or shared. It will never be shown at an individual level. It would only be shown together with others, but it could be examined. It's just that statistics that are shared externally would need to involve them and others. Others yet might say, look, I have no real concerns here. I'm willing to allow my data for the sake of a publication or what have you to be used as an example in a de-identified way, in a way without my name, and maybe it's no geographic information and no information about particular dates. And someone else might say, well, look, you could show all but the geographic locations. So these are what I call tiered opt-in. Some might opt into different levels of that. It's a bit more work for the researcher, but it might allow recruiting people who otherwise wouldn't join. And it might allow the REB to be comfortable with it. Because they say, you can let participants address their particular risk level, risk comfort levels, according to their risk preference. So this is a strategy we have used. It's been quite successful. In other cases, I believe a study with Cheryl, for example, my recollection, I could be off, was that within the ethics submission, we did not seek the ability to summarize information or share it publicly at an individual level. So it was just across the board. It was aggregate promises. This is important. It's important to assure, of course, the IRB, you're working with de-identified data, data from which names and addresses and birth dates and so on have been stripped. But more than that, in terms of the communication, the dissemination of it, you want to be clear. And then providing background information on Ethica is key, and Ethica provides a lot of backup for that. Okay, so some points of discussion with IRBs. There's a set of repeated issues that comes back. One is the encryption thing, and again, I don't know why it's not here, but the fact that Ethica encrypts on device and in transit and sending information. Another thing is, for a lot of studies, what you're collecting, much of it is in the public sphere. People's patterns of physical activity in a work environment, or people's movement within a building or within a certain geographical area. There's a lot of information that Ethica collects that's kind of in the public forum. And that sort of information needs to be highlighted to the REB. It's not like, we are collecting people's, innermost thoughts on an ongoing basis, or we're collecting their stress hormone levels every 3 minutes or something like that. We are collecting a lot of data about someone's location or aspects of who they're with or their level of sedentary behavior that in many cases is visible to others most of the time anyway. There's a consent process that's absolutely essential, and it's very important that REBs realize that while this sort of information is collected by numerous commercial actors through different means than Ethica, Ethica is a system which works hand in hand to secure consent, informed consent from individuals, which is lacking for the many, many collectors of this information that operate on smartphones routinely. Apple, Google, Facebook, et cetera, just collecting gobs of information. We at least go through a meaningful consent process where we're very clear about what data were provided, and we allow them to pause, right? And we saw this yesterday. Pressing that pause button can stop all data collection through those automatic mechanisms for a defined time. Alternatively, they can disable, for many studies where you make it optional, they can disable in the app, say GPS, or disable step count, disable the records or Bluetooth contacts. In other cases, on their phone, they can turn off GPS, and Ethica doesn't have access to GPS. So there's multiple levels of opting out. And Ethica, as an interface, tries to make it very easy for someone to request privacy. We built that into our systems from the first, and it bears noting that from a participant recruitment standpoint, that raises confidence and trust with participants, right? That they can opt out at any time. If they want a time where they have more privacy, they can be guaranteed privacy for a period of time. And that's respectful. It's respecting them as persons, right? But it also is something which is helpful to know. In Ethica, it does record during this period of time the data was absent because it was requested, for censoring was requested for this period of time. So it's distinct from just it's no data as one. Am I right about that, Mohammed? So when someone pauses for a time, that's distinct from the data is just gone, like they turn off their phone. So we know the phone was on, but they requested. One sobering thing I will share with people, there's only one study that we've ever run which has involved quite a few participants opting out explicitly. Okay? Actively choosing to mask the data collection. That was a study involving lower income participants where we handed out, pre-Ethica, this goes back to 2010 or 2009, we handed out phones. It was predominantly a lower income group. And there were, this was a concern. It was a study entirely with women as the participants. It was for gestational diabetes. And it was a clinically recruited group. And a number of family members of these predominantly lower SES women, lower socioeconomic position women, some family members expressed concern about data collection. And in other cases, the women decided to pause data collection. So we actually had quite a bit of data that was deliberately requested for being censored. It was not collected. And I felt very proud that we could secure their trust to the level that they could request it with confidence that we would observe it, and indeed we did. I've never really found it a big problem for analysis. This was a study Alan was in, the GDS. I would note there's a lot of, you know, this sort of information collected by actors. So I mentioned different options for opting out of studies. One type of arrangement that I've long considered as attractive, but we have yet to really act on, is what I like to call data escrow-based studies. The idea here is that you collect data from a set of participants, but you do so with the understanding that data will only be used under certain circumstances. So, for example, in the event of a positive outcome for their disease prognosis or a negative outcome, in the event of a public health emergency or some sort of, an outbreak, for example, we will use their retroactively provided data. Otherwise, that data is tossed. That data is discarded. The idea here is that the data is not used most of the time. It's only used in the event that there's a strong need to do so, say for health authorities. It may be that larger superset of data is provided, say geographic patterns and contact patterns, for use only in those circumstances. And otherwise, the data is restricted to self-report and step counts or what have you. So this is sort of contingent data collection. It's not so applicable for most research studies, but when it comes to health system use, it offers a particular place that it might offer. So those were some, again, I kept my comments here in an abbreviated fashion. I've tried to share with you some tips, pointers, suggestions, observations. I would say that by and large, it has been a quite good journey with REB boards and IRBs, but it's a journey with highly variegated experiences and with ups and downs and with very non-monotonic progression. In other words, it doesn't just get better each successive year, it changes. Mohammed, if you are interested, could probably talk with you about European standards, the GDPR for data protection within Europe, and how that enters into this picture. It has required Ethica to accommodate it, and Ethica is used successfully in a number of I think most notably in Netherlands, Switzerland, and UK as well. I think UK is still part of it. So what a weird group. So in any case, that's a little bit on the human ethics side, okay? The plan is for me to continue on to talk about recruitment, but if possible, to pause for refreshments. Are those refreshments yet here? The refreshments have arrived. Okay, together with them, the cavalry. So I will break now, and we'll resume in another 10 to 15 minutes. 15 minutes with some comments on participant recruitment, okay? And then we'll dive in to the projects again, okay? Thank you very much. And TAs, thank you for coming over. Cavalry. I think I'll begin the next session also with questions about ethics. We'll have a discussion about that before we go on to recruitment. So if there's any questions, concerns, dialogue that's needed, we can have that discussion then with participation by Mohammed as well.